This information is really important because those of you that already have it, you should go over it every once in a while. Because I give you teachings and I give you material, and then I wait and observe to see if your lifestyle is conforming to the teachings that you're getting. If it's not, it means that you're ignoring, the teachings that you're getting here. And if you were going to be qualifying to be an astronaut and you're ignoring what's being taught, they probably won't send you to the moon, okay? And most of you want to get someplace with God. You want to hit the moon, you want to hit the stars. So when you're reading something, and then this has a check in your mind, you think it's your spirit, but it's your mind, because your mind wars against what? Your spirit. And you say, I just don't feel good about this. It's usually your mind that's fighting it, because your mind is very religious, right? So it has its own doctrine. And if you came from a church environment, even more so, your mind is going to be fighting everything that you're going to, much of a lot that you're going to be receiving here. But this information, I think, is very important. For example, in the fourth paragraph, in the paragraph of Isaiah 57:7, these I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house will be called a house of prayer for all, what, nations. So the primary thing of the house of God is what?
Prayer.
It's a little bit like there's a real design purpose that we enter here with a prayerful heart. And then we learn of his ways and we worship our God and the King. But he basically puts it first, prayer. So when you walk into a library, what is one of the words that you're going to hear, see there? Silent, quiet. Because the primary purpose of there is to people that are want to read. Some of them are studying. Some of them are receiving education. So you realize that, yeah, the primary purpose is to learn something, then that's why you're there. But you learn in what kind of a way? Quiet kind of a way. So in the house of God is a place to learn, to worship God, but its primary purpose is communications with God. Because you're here to communicate with him. So therefore, when you walk in here, your reverence changes, just like your respect and reverence changes when you go to a public library. And what would happen if you ignore that respect and reverence in a library? The security guide would say, you're out of here because you are out of sequence, you're out of step, you're out of the pulse of what this place is all about. So when we realize what the house of God is, it's not a playhouse, one. It's not a networking house, two. It's not a social house, three. So therefore, if you are utilizing the house of God for networking, for business, or whatever, you walk in here and you see customers, that is wrong. Why do you think we have the money box outside and not inside? Because we respect God's house so much that we don't make emphasis, quote, on money. That is a Western mentality. All right? So we put it on the outside. Every time you walk out and you see the box out there, it should remind you that things of this world should remain outside. Okay? But it's there because God says that we must give our tithing, you know, to the Lord. But we don't make such emphasis on money, 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 that we're going to try to drain you from all your resources. So for a Jew, a synagogue represents the highest level of what? Dignity. Okay? Dignity, reverence, respect. And there was a time also when going to meet God was considered as important as going to meet an important or great leader. That's why I said when you walk in here, you're meeting God. Hallelujah. And so when you're meeting a great leader, even people that go to meet the Pope, and they are in the, what is the room before you enter? The foyer, are you loud there? And the foyer, no, because you know he could hear you. You know, just besides the door. So why do we come here and laugh and guilt and all that stuff? You know, we show no respect. It's that we're bringing that box in here. We're bringing the world in here. You say, well, you know, we're just friends and we're just meeting each other. But you are in the foyer. You do it with respect and with honor. And you keep your voice and tone at a level that is pleasing and respectful to God. Because here is where you are showing as an example. You're showing other people the highest respect that you have for the King of the universe. I hope that this makes sense. Okay. All right. So, so now etiquette is described as that which is good breeding. So when you have etiquette, is good breeding. So when you're at a formal dinner especially, how are you going to eat? Are you going to eat with your fingers? Oh, how are you going to wipe your mouth? With your shirt? With your t-shirt? No, that's etiquette. It says no, no, no. I mean, there is it shows that you have good breeding. Now, what I'm sharing to you is good breeding habits in the house of God. We must be different than the churches are. If they are anything goes, let it be what they're going to be. That's what they're teaching. That's what they're saying is okay. This is a Jewish synagogue, Messianic synagogue, Judeo-Messianic synagogue. We practice things that God has taught his people from ancient times. And if you have not ever known them, this is where you're going to learn them. And if you're pleased with that, say amen. So it has to do with etiquette, with behavior and politeness. And an interesting Jewish thought about etiquette is that someone cannot conduct himself according to the rules of etiquette if Torah is not in his mouth. Mm-hmm. So what did God tell Jeremiah? I shall put my words into your mouth so that there would be etiquette. All right? So when you shout, when you're loud, when you're using the house of God for fun and socializing, then you don't have spiritual etiquette. It means that God's Torah is not in your mouth. All right? But if God's Torah is in your mouth, then you're oozing with God's anointing. You're oozing, as it were, with the glow of God's glory and presence. That is what's going to draw people inside of the temple and the synagogue of God's house. Amen? That's what's going to bring young people to want to stay. They don't hear the all this socializing. They say, this is the same as my church. There's no difference, you know. But it's different here. Wow, I sense an anointing. I sense a presence. I sense my spirit want to be drawn to God. I don't know why I sense this, but I'm picking it up from everyone around me, you know. Hello? All right. Even in hospitals, what are we doing in hospitals? Quiet, you know. I mean, people are receiving their healing, and they need, some kind of tranquility there. So there is but one end for the purpose of a house of worship, and that is to unite man with God and with his fellow man. So true spiritual worship, of course, is led by the Ruach, the Holy Spirit. And the firmest and most sacred bond of union between man and his neighbor with God is usually where? In the house of God. Mm-hmm. The firmest and most sacred bond is here, in his house. And as a people of God, our only end is really, we want joy unspeakable and full of glory. Mm-hmm. That is acceptable to God. Happiness is acceptable to him. Okay, then I have something on spiritual thought about clothing. Is the Sabbath clothing should be that the Sabbath clothing should be distinguished from everyday apparel. So the Western world is very far too relaxed about this, especially in America. So without even mentioning the proper dress, to meet someone really very important, like the Pope, for example, in the Vatican. Many have had their stories. Even Obama's wife had her own story. She dressed wrong to meet the Pope. Mm-hmm. If you're going to meet Queen of England, what's her name? And you dress wrong, you won't get in. Yeah. But if you're going to meet the King of Kings, you can dress trashy if you want to. No. Why does a human being, a king or queen or president, why do you have to dress so nice for that one and not dress nice for God? So God taught the Jewish people through Joseph, when you go meet the king, you change your clothing and you dress the best that you can. Do you know that some of the islands of the sea, they do that all the time? Yeah. Out there in Tahiti and all those islands in the, Solomon Islands. The women, when they come to church, they dress beautiful for God, you know. Why not us? Well, we've been Americanized, right? We dress like the Americans dress. We don't observe the ways of God when it comes to God. We know that He saved us as a sinner and we just come to Him that way. But I tell you something, the best thing we got going in life is change. And if you want to keep the lifestyle of this world, go ahead and keep it. But I think that you might just miss out on some of the benefits of God's glory and God's anointing at a different, higher level. If God told Joseph to dress differently than the average person when he goes before Pharaoh, how much more should we dress when we come into the presence of God? So why do we dress the way that we dress? Two, we've been westernizing our thinking. Two, peer pressure. If you dress nicely and no one else does, then you feel out of place, right? But the fact of the matter is that if you dress nice for God, that other person is going to feel that they are out of place, and pretty soon they're going to begin to change. They're waiting for you to change first so that they will change. I hope that makes a little bit of understanding. Yeah. So I think that this is really vital in our approach to understanding this area. Clothes do indeed make the woman, right? And the man, and of course they can also make or break a visit to someone important. Interesting to note, again, I'm speaking about the Pope in Rome, men should consider to not wear jeans or sneakers, but instead slacks and a shirt. So when you go to a real observant Jewish synagogue, you'll never see a Jew with jeans, shorts, slacks. You never see that, you know. Why? Because they're going to see the King of Kings, you know. So it's really a perception, it's a mindset, and I want you to know that I think it's important. I won't bring it to you, to your attention personally, but I will teach it from here, okay? And I will let you know that you might be more pleasing to God. He says, well, you know, these are my ways. He says, I will teach you of my ways. My ways are as far as the heavens is from the earth, the north is from the south, the east is from the... How vastly different are His ways? Do we want His ways or do we want the Roman, Greek, pagan ways? Come on, you make the decision yourself, you know. Choose ye this day whom you shall serve. I put before you life and death. He said, come on, I want you to choose the things that pertain to life and not darkness. So on October 31st, what are we going to have? A choice of what? Light or darkness. And so what are the stores selling? Light stuff? They're selling dark stuff. Saying, God says, I put before you life or death. And the majority of the people in the planet are choosing darkness. You know, and this whole thing about, you know, trick or treat is about actually bringing the treats to the demons. They're bringing the treats to the demons, you know. They're bringing the candies to the demons. That's why the kids come dressed as what? Angels? Not really. Mostly devils and demons, because that's where it all begins. Why should we be a part of the demonic world? That's a world of darkness. He says, well, there is nothing wrong in having fun. This is why we have all the feasts. God has his fun time for you. All right? We have so many feasts going that you don't have time for all this stuff. And I tell you, how much money are people spending on candy and costumes on Halloween? You give me a guess. Millions of tens of millions of dollars are being spent for what? To promote the kingdom of darkness instead of his wonderful light. Okay, a museum employee told us, CNS, that's the news network, that dressing decently is a common courtesy. One is, after all, a guest in a place deserving respect when visiting the museum, or a pilgrim in a place of worship when visiting the basilica. Okay, Jessica, why don't you give this to some of our people that are just coming in back there. So even if you went to Israel with me, they won't let you into some of the holy sites. Okay? Because you're showing too much flesh. And when you're showing flesh, it indicates that you want to have sex. Okay? So you might say you can take it to an extreme, but this is why men do not shake hands with a woman. How about Facebook? Okay, let me put it this way. You women, would you like to receive letters from a married man if you're married? No. What about if you found a picture in your husband's wallet of another woman? How would that make you feel? You wouldn't like that at all. Well, Facebook has found a way around it, because now men can have pictures of women there, and women can send pictures to them. Do you see how this world works? You don't feel comfortable with the man having the picture. How about if he says, I just got it out of Facebook and put it in my wallet? Well, what's the difference between Facebook and the wallet with the picture of another man if you're a woman? Or how about if you're a woman and you as a husband see your wife with pictures of all these men? Would you be comfortable with that? That's why the Orthodox Jews, Facebook, you'll find that there is a separation. They have a site for women and a site for men. And they don't exchange pictures. Why? They respect and reverence the husband. We don't do that in America. We do not consult with each other. First, if you want the wife's picture, why don't you ask the husband for the picture? Do you think he'll give you his wife's picture? No, he won't. So you have to find a way around so she doesn't know that you have been in Facebook doing all this kind of stuff. I tell you, you're not going to get this teaching somewhere else, okay? Turn around and tell someone, that's why I'm glad I'm here. All right. Now, if this teaching is too hard for you, I tell you, it's because you never even got the fundamentals of this to begin with, where you started out with. So what to wear in a synagogue service? Now, since the synagogue for Jews is more important than a presidential palace, hello there? Yes. It is important, page 2, to them to wear appropriate clothing. On certain occasions that do not involve regular worship service, more casual attire, of course, is acceptable. But for feasts, for example, and Shabbat service, and these are very considered more formal, okay? Usually women wear dresses and men wear suits. Younger children can usually get away with their play clothes. But most of the time, you will find in Jewish congregations children wearing, you know, nice long pants and a nice shirt. and many times with the tie as well. Messianic congregations do not observe the very strict Orthodox dress, but dress appropriately as they would to honor God. Okay? So I'm not asking anyone to dress like the Orthodox Jews and come with these big hats, you know, and these coats and all that stuff. But dressed how? Appropriately as you would to honor God. Mm-hmm. Now, except difference, there's a difference between the Reform and the Orthodox synagogues or temples, all men and boys. The little ones rarely keep them on, but are expected to cover their heads. And this is often optional at Reform services, and out of respect, even the non-Jewish guest should follow the custom of the synagogue and wear a kippah. That's why we have the kippahs outside. Now, men who have been bar mitzvah also typically put on a tallit. This is not expected of non-Jews. So really, if you're not Jewish, it's not expected of you and required of you to do it, you know. But the Jewish people do it, and you may politely decline if offered one. Today, in more liberal synagogues, women sometimes also wear kippah and tallit, but this is not obligatory. Now, I'll read, first of all, what the dictionary says about modesty. Do you know what modesty is? Everyone knows what modesty is? Oh, I don't have to teach it then. Okay? So, we know modesty is a mode of dress. Mm-hmm. It's a mode of dress, and the way a person behaves is intended not to encourage sexual attraction in others. So when you dress, especially women, you should say, am I what? Inviting sexual attraction in others. Why? Because men are thinking sexually every 60 seconds. So if you dress a certain way, what are you inviting? Sexual attraction. Mm-hmm. In other words, standards vary widely. In the house of God, it cannot be considered inappropriate. It can be considered inappropriate or immodest to reveal certain parts of the body, such as cleavage. That would be considered inappropriate. And why is that? Because it invites sexual attraction. Yes, now you're distracting a man by that type of dress. Showing, what about, or legs showing above the knee? Mm-hmm. So if you are in Israel, and women cross their legs like this, what's going to happen? They're going to see all of this area, right? So in Israel, you cannot even cross your legs. Mm-hmm. There's certain ways of sitting that women should not sit. And that is that if your legs are like this, a man considers that you want sex like right now. Okay? So, I mean, if you don't understand the man mentality, men have a certain way of looking at women to look for certain signs. But if women are not careful on how they dress, then you're sending a message. And the person begins to communicate with you in a very light way at first, and you didn't even realize it, that you were sending out these messages. And you're creating in him the release of sexual juices from his brain, as it were, that now are compelling him to follow through. So in the house of God, it can be considered inappropriate. Okay? In a synagogue, a modest woman would dress in such a way so as to not encourage that kind of attention. In a synagogue, Jewish men wear skull caps, kippahs, yarmulkes, and Gentile men should put one on if they feel comfortable. Jewish women who are married will have some head covering. Okay? Now, all of this is in regards to being respectful and breaking down the this this whole thing that we're equal to God. We're not equal to God. All right? We show great respect and reverence. Even if you went to our Iolani Palace, certain respect is required there. Okay, dealing with distractions, cell phones or iPods are not permitted in a synagogue. And although they can be used for looking up scriptures, I think for this new technology can be useful for some folks who can look up scriptures much faster than thumbing through pages. If electronic devices are to be used, educating on what is acceptable and when it is acceptable to use such devices is important. Now, in Orthodox congregations, they don't use that. And I explained to you why. Does someone remember? Why? That's one of the reasons why. You're tempted to okay, he said this, now I'm going to check it out over there, you know. But also because they have been instructed from early age on. Remember, they've been studying since they were what? Yeah. And this is why the Lord says, instruct the child in the way he should grow. So when he grows up, he will not depart. So when they're already a teenage, they don't bring their cell phones and they don't bring their laptops or their iPods to Torah study because they have been trained to absorb in just listening. And they'll take down notes, you know. So they don't need the laptop there, and they don't need all these devices there as if they were out in a secular community. And because he shall teach us of his ways. So everything that I'm teaching here, if your brain level of learning is at a certain level, you really won't need all these gadgets around you. You just absorb it, and it becomes layer upon layer. And this is why we're training you to take that weekly Torah study home, because that's going to build upon you these layers of ability to be able to study correctly. Yeah. And soon you'll realize that you're getting enough information here that you never need to get into the internet, except that I would say go in this direction, go in that direction, because you can get lost in what kind of a world it's called? The World Wide Web. You can get lost out there very quickly, yeah. And you come back with stuff that God never intended for you to have yet. Yeah. But this is the interesting thing about it, is that birds of the same, they flock together. When you begin to get into stuff that God never intended to you to get in, others will be hungry for that stuff. But God never intended for you to have it. So now you're going to start a bad habit. Because we are creatures of habits. And this creature of habits is that if God didn't want me to get into something, and I get into it, and I get you into it, now you are into it, and the world's into it. All over the world. This is why we must learn systematically from the ground up. Okay? So you build a skyscraper from the top down. Is that it right? No. How can you build a skyscraper from the top down? Do you begin to put the curtains even before you put the walls of a home up? No, you cannot even put the curtains first. What in the world are you doing putting up curtains all around the world when you don't even have the kind of solid foundation that you need? An inspector has to come and inspect the foundation, and you have not even built the proper foundation yet, even before you get to the next level, whether it be electricity or plumbing. Hello? Because you clear out the land, and then you put down the layers of cement, and then you have to get that inspected to be sure that it's been done right. Has someone been inspecting your foundation? Do you have a foundation? What do you have? Well, you have all these windows and you have all these curtains. And God says, put those on hold. Okay? In fact, just give them back to me. And when I see you, You know, I learned this years ago. My scholarly father taught me these things. But I also had another scholar teacher that would teach me these things. And he would say, you know, the things that you're learning, you know, there's a lot of people not ready for that. You better put them on hold, like right now, you know. So I just put them on hold, you know. Yeah. How about taking telephone numbers and email addresses and all that stuff? Giving private information. Your cell phone is your private information. How can you give your private information to a stranger? Someone that you really don't know. Because there's five levels, right? First, there are strangers. Second level is what? Acquaintance. He's not even an acquaintance. He's still a stranger. Stranger, acquaintance. Then possibly become friends, then good friends, then best friends. Then you're ready to die for that person. What happens is that you give a stranger your cell phone number or your email or your Facebook, and you are ready to die. You don't want to die. This is what's going on in the world today, and even in the body of the Lord. They do not understand that these are the ways of the world. And we think that it's all right. Why? Because everyone's doing it. Okay. Let's do it because everyone's doing it. Well, let's admit the truth. We're doing it because we haven't been taught the right way. And because you do it, your children's going to do it. And this is why we have a problem. This is why we have men praying over kids and teenagers, yeah, because we have allowed them. And your daughter, your son, don't want you to look at their private email stuff. Why don't they want you to look that way? Why can't they be transparent with you as a parent? Are they really over 18? Until they're at least 18 years of age, they must be transparent with you. It's the lack of teaching. And we just absolutely give our trust to our kids 100%. And when we give our trust to them 100% and we do not monitor them, they are out at nighttime. And you don't know that they're out at nighttime. What do you mean nighttime? I don't mean necessarily after 10, but that could be true. But nighttime is anything that is darkness. Okay? They're out in the darkness. And that's why they don't want you to look at their email stuff, you know. But we need to raise a godly generation. Well, how do we do it now? It's too late. Tell God that it's too late. Tell God that he cannot open the sea for you. Tell Joshua that he cannot stop the sun and the moon. Tell Daniel that the lions are going to eat him, okay? And if they respond and tell you that you are right, then you continue in the lifestyle that you are. But if you give them 3 or 4 minutes, they will convince you that you can change everything around you. But you first have to change. And when you first change, the light begins to glow from you. It begins to ooze out from you. It fills your home. It fills your atmosphere. It changes your climate, you know. And then your kids will begin to come to the light, because they'll realize that what you have is something that they really want. Work at it, all right? Let's give God glory. Okay, so did everyone that didn't get one get one? How many of these do we have left? Okay, bring those up. So I made 20 copies. Okay, now give these out to those that lost theirs. Raise your hand. Mm-hmm. Anyone lost theirs or need one? Okay, who wants one? Okay, all right. Because these I want to give out today. Okay, so now I want to talk about this month. Does someone know the name of this month? Cheshvan. Say Cheshvan. Isvan is a very important month because we talked about water, and this is the month about water as well. Mm-hmm. First of all, does anyone know what Rosh Chodesh is? Rosh is what? Like Rosh Hashanah? Rosh is what? First or new? Yeah. Okay, so the Jewish calendar follows the lunar year, right? And the renewal of the moon marks the beginning of the month. So Rosh Chodesh, which means head of the month. Chodesh means month. Rosh Chodesh. It's not Chodesh, but it's Chodesh. But we say Chodesh because it's so easier. But usually K would be the only one that you say Chodesh, but it's actually Chodesh. So everyone say Rosh Chodesh. It marks the beginning of the month. And so Rosh Chodesh, Chodesh, which means the head of the month, celebrates the start of a new what? Then therefore, month. And what calendar? The Jewish calendar. So throughout history, our light has waxed and waned, but even in utter darkness, it has never been extinguished. Cheshbon, today is the 11th of Cheshbon. This day today is the 11th of Cheshbon. So it is the second month of the Jewish calendar. And we begin to count from Rosh Hashanah. And we celebrated Rosh Hashanah, right? Now we're going to celebrate Hanukkah. And Cheshvan is the only month that does not have any holidays or special commands from God. And the reason why it is considered as the month that is being reserved for the Mashiach, the Messiah, because this would be the month that we would inaugurate the third temple. So when they begin to build the third temple, it's going to be built, guess when?
This month?
Yeah, this month. This is why when I bring you the study in the Jewish temple, and I have friends that are actually the official photographers of every element that's going into the temple. And so we have access to every single gold vessel that is already built there, the menorah and everything else in Israel. So if we go to Israel next year, we'll take you there. But everything is ready, and including all of the, you know, the attire, the garments of the priest. The stones are being carved. Negotiations are taking place behind the scenes regard to exactly where it's going to be built. I think that one of the things that's going to happen is that Israel is going to come into a major, major, major agreement that many will not like, but it will give them complete authority over the Temple Mount. This is a calculated risk because I'm talking about giving all of old Jerusalem over to the other side, the Palestinians. And if they do that, then the Orthodox Jews do not see it necessarily as a big problem as long as they have the Temple Mount. Okay? And the government of Israel do not see it as a big problem more than the rabbis, because they've already given Bethlehem. They've already given Nazareth and other cities that are very strong Jewish and biblical historic and Christian background. So this would be the month. So maybe next year you begin at this time of the year, you begin to see the actual building of that. Things, remember, as the days are shortened now, so they become shorter, so we will reach the month of Cheshbon very quickly. It's like, wow, again another feast, and the next one, and then pretty soon Passover again, and pretty soon Sukkot again. I mean, Purim too in between. Things are moving quite fast. So, the great flood in the days of Noah began in this month. So this makes this month a very critical and very important month. It began in the month of Heshbon. And it was a year later, also in the month of Heshbon, 1 year later, that Noah left the ark. So what two things happened in the month of Heshbon? One, the flood began, and then the flood ended, and that was the time in Heshbon that Noah left the ark. These are two very important, significant things, because we know those stories, but maybe we did not know the month of when these things happened, because when we begin to study the months, then we realize that there are important things here that God wants us to know more than just the story, okay? So in the month of Heshbon, we commemorate what it's called in Hebrew, the Yartzit. The Yartzit is the anniversary of passing. And what anniversary of passing? It is the anniversary of the passing of the matriarch Rachel, or Rachel in Hebrew, Rachel. And she's buried on the road to Beit Lechem, the house of bread. And throughout the ages, and it's still there. Okay? And of course, now you know that the Palestinians are trying to destroy every Jewish tomb. And they're messing things up as fast as they can. What do you think the ISIS would do if they ever came and got hold of America? Destroy every church, every synagogue, anything that is not ISIS. What do you think would happen if the ISIS took over all of Israel? Every synagogue would disappear, you know. All the tombs would disappear for sure. They've already been doing it in Iraq and Iran and all those countries like Afghanistan. They've been tearing down those ancient tombs that have been there for thousands of years. Why? Because only Allah and their form of Allah, the Sharia law, is being wanted to be implemented in America. And I've taught this in colleges, but I will teach this sometime here. It's important that you might know that. I call it, I'll give you the name later. Okay, so now, so this is the month, I would call it the anticlimax, of course, of the previous month, and the previous month was the month of what? Tishri. And in the month of Tishri, we were climaxing everything, right? What were we climaxing? The high holidays. Yeah, and we were climaxing with those high holidays, Sukkot, our spiritual experiences. So it was, of course, the feast of our soul. Mm-hmm. And in a sense, also we were receiving a vocation and a training and education about these feasts. So this month is the anticlimax of that month. Now, as we enter into, we're in the 11th day of this month of Heshbon, now we could say real life begins, because we went on a big high, right? Yeah. Now, real life begins. Mm-hmm. We're back to the daily mundane grind, as it were. Vacation is over. So this is the time to take the inspiration and all that we gained in the month. It's like, what happens to the bear? He hibernates. But how is he able to hibernate? He ate a lot first. Enough to hibernate for whatever months that he needed to hibernate. He needed to have the strength of, we needed to have now the strength of those high holidays. if you were in it just for the fun of it, but not for the, I would say, the educational part of it, the learning part of it, then you will remain on a low wanting to get another high. And so because you didn't really get what you wanted, needed out of it, you'll go to outer space to get it. This is where you hit the internet because you didn't get filled. But you should have got filled because we taught you very extensively so that you may begin to walk in His ways. And we gave you the Torah portion so that you can study it every week. So that when this time came, you're hibernating spiritually on all of that awesome food and all of that awesome experience that you received in the climax of those high holidays. So Rachel's tomb was on the road to Bet Lechem. Now this month of, again, now as we're entering now into this month, this is the time to take inspiration. Everything that you've gained. The current Hebrew month that we're in, Chesbon, I say and I call it, is a classically referred to as, you add the word M-A-R before Chesbon, Chesbon, and what is the word that you get there? M-A-R, you get what? Mar Chesbon. Okay? So we'll look at the prefix of M-A-R, mar. The word mar. In the Hebrew word, the word mar means, remember you came from a real high right now, right? And why are you hibernating? It's because this is the month that is also considered a month of bitterness, bitter month. It becomes a bitter month. So our great sages and teachers of ancient time, they connect the fact that there are no special occasions that occur in this month. This is why I said there's no feast this month. There is no commandments of God, you know, but this is a month that is called bitter. And even the month of Av, the month when we mourn the destruction of the Holy Temple in Jerusalem, is not referred to as bitter, but this month is referred as bitter. Pretty soon we're going to begin all over again introspection, right? Thus, both the festive days, and there's days that are not festive, because the festive days are called like positive or plus days, and those that are not are considered like low days, because they're not, you know, way up there. But God always has a feast coming up, right, to bring you right back up. I mean, what would happen to you if you are flowing with, what is the word when someone can pick up a car because someone's underneath? Then, what would happen to you if you're on adrenaline 24 hours, 24/7? You can sleep, you'd be worn out, you know, it's just high energy. So God brings you back down to, I mentioned earlier, reality. The reality is that you're going to have to face your teens. The reality is that you have to face that boss. The reality is that you're going to have to face things from your spouse that you may not want to face. She might say no to you when you really want, yeah, you know. So these are realities. You're back to reality. And this is very important. Now, where was Noah and the eight? And where was the ark? Way up there. But they had to come back to reality, all right? And how was the ark pitched? Inside and out. And why was it pitched inside and out? Because if you're not pitched inside and out, you will flow out of God's will and you go into the world. And God already knew what was going to happen. And what was going to happen is this. If you allow the pitching to go on in the inside and the outside, you'll preserve the holy tongue. Because what's coming is babble. And it's going to cause all except one language to become a language of confusion. This is where our struggle is today. Unless you're rooted and grounded in God's Hebraic teaching, deep down in God's Word, you're going to have a mind that's scattered all over the place. And that scattering has to do with Babylon. Babylon and language go together. As the language goes, so the nation goes. So it's significant again to know that the original name of this month was, again, Mar Cheshvan. The Babylonian name was adopted when the Jews went through 70-year exile between the first and the second temple. So the original name for the month was, actually before that, they called it Bul. B-U-L. So it denotes, when you get down to the root of Mar Cheshbon, it denotes of drying up as the leaves begin to decay with the approach of the month of what? Autumn, right? So this is the month of Cheshbon, and what is happening to the leaves not in Hawaii? It's changing. They're starting to dry up. So now you get a connection with Cheshbon, you know, in this month, and a downside, even a downside to nature. When the leaves were now beautiful across America, now they're turning brown and they're dying out. And in fact, they're going to fall off the trees, right? Mm-hmm. So that's why in the original name of Mar Cheshbon, it's drying up. So clearly the month of Mar Cheshvan, or Bul, as its name suggests, is a month of that. It's a month of when you're feeling low. It's kind of like a month of darkness. The flowers are decaying. By 5 more minutes. Okay, a little bit more. We find two other events that occurred in the month of Cheshvan. The first was the flood in the times of Noah. Of course, we said that. And the flood began on the 17th of Cheshvan. And the following year, what happened the following year? Noah came out of the ark. And that took place on I'm giving you the dates now, okay? It happened on the 17th of Cheshvan, the flood, and on the 28th or 7th of Cheshvan, that's when Noah and his sons were able to come and family out of the ark, and they disembarked on the 28th of Cheshvan. We are on the 11th, okay? So when we reach the 28th of this month, if you have the Hebrew calendar, make a little circle there and say, remind yourself, this is the day that Noah came out of the ark. So another thing about this month is that this is the month that the rainy season begins. Mm-hmm. So when was the month that all the rain came down? Cheshvan. Remember, it began to rain in the month of Cheshvan, the 17th of Cheshvan. This world was flooded, the flood of Noah. This was the month of the death of Jacob's wife, Rachel. And it was also the month of the birth of her son, Benjamin. He died just before She died just before he was born, right? Which occurred on the 11th of Heshvan. It was the 11th of Heshvan that Benjamin was born. And Benjamin's tribe is the tribe second to what? Second to none. Mm-hmm. So why would Benjamin be born on the month of Heshvan and be known as the tribe of second to none? Because now it shows that during this dark time, it is your time to prove that you are a person second to none. That you can go through this month and survive. Does someone know the name of the person that lived the longest in the Bible? Methuselah? Yeah, Methuselah. Well, it is also the time or the month that Methuselah was born. Oh, excuse me. The death of Methuselah's death. So he died on the very same day that Benjamin was born. But both happened in the month of Heshvan. So now you look at the birth of Benjamin, second to none. You look at the death of Methuselah at the same time, and he lived the longest of any human being. And what do you get out of that? God wants to birth you to be what? A person that's second to none, because you will be in Torah. And if you are that way, he'll give you longevity. Do you get that? So this is the month that you can show God that you are capable, taking the bull by the horns, as it were, taking everything that's in your hands, every tool, everything, and moving it forward. You become second to none in the eyes of God. He'll give you longevity in this life. Longevity, what? Physical longevity? In the kingdom, it is spiritual longevity. That means that you will outlast, your ministry will not be cut short. God will not need to stop you from what you're doing. He's going to give you a green light. Mm-hmm. You know, before we moved here to Hawaii about almost 35 years ago, one of the things that I promised God was that I will always move forward as long as I saw a green light. Yeah. So this is part of why God gives me longevity, to be able to have staying power while everyone around you is either dying or their ministers are fading or closing up. You will have longevity. Hallelujah. Would you give him thanks for that? Hallelujah. So what is the connection then between these two events again? Someone tell me. What do they reveal to you in the month of Heshvan? Say that louder. Yes, he does. Mm-hmm. Anyone want to put it in a different spin? Another word? Yes. Yeah, that's good. The cycle of life, as you're going through the cycle of life, and your whole cycle of life, it has a lot to do with how you began that cycle. Okay? You begin it right. That's why a born-again experience is very important, right? Yeah. Behold, all things are passed away. All things become new. You start a new cycle. Now, you may have been a Christian for many years, but when you come into Torah, you begin a new what? A new spiritual cycle in your life. Is that what's happening to you? Yeah. I mean, we had the nice talk last night. This happens to everyone here. We have people here that were awesomely great in what they did in their churches, but when they came here, they finally realized, wow, I'm starting a new cycle, and I have to relearn everything. And I, now I have to be, I have to confess, maybe I didn't know everything that I thought I really knew. But I had prestige, I had position, I had authority, people came up to me. That's a high trip, right? It's a difficult trip to come down from. Rose, did you find it hard to come down to? Very difficult to come down from that high, you know. It's a culture shock when you come into here. Because when you come here, now you're realizing, wow, you know, I don't like this idea because I know too much, but now I don't know nothing. Wow, you know. Yes.
Mm.
Yes. Wow. Yes. Now you have staying power.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, that's that circle. You know, you start the circle right, and then the Word of God says, what happened when you started out so right? And now I have to cut you off. So the axe is at the root of the tree, ready to cut the tree down. But he started right. And you cut your cycle down because you didn't have staying power. Because the temptations and the distractions were greater than what you you thought. This is why a lot of people will come for a very short time, and they cannot take it, and they'll walk out. It becomes too much, you know. But let me tell you, this is why we call it advanced Torah teaching. Even though I'm not even at the level that I really want to teach you, it's still advanced because you never had even the preliminary teachings in this particular area. So for most, it is advanced teaching. Staying power? Okay. Staying power is the kind of power that that all of the disciples didn't have except John. Who was the only one at the cross with Yeshua at the cross? Yohanan, John. The other ones did not have staying power. Why did John have staying power and the other ones didn't? Do you see pictures of John in the Passover doing what?
Leaning.
You see? Because that's the story of John. He was leaning on Torah. Yeah. And the other 12 were not leaning on Torah. And so God said this. I know what you're going through. I'm going to use you. But now I have to infuse you with my Holy Spirit. Because after my Holy Spirit comes upon you, then you're going to lean upon me. Okay? So there's this really shows us something, that the majority do not lean. Only two of the initial 12 of the tribes entered the promised land, because the other 10 were not leaning. Joshua and Caleb said, God did say. Why did they say that and the other ones didn't say that? Because they were in their natural highs all the time. I tell you one thing, if that tribe at that time had computers, all would have computers except two. And there would be who? Joshua and Caleb. You got that? Uh-huh. And what happened? They completed their cycle. The other ones were in the World Wide Web. They were going from galaxy to galaxy all over the place. And you keep hearing me saying this, but I'm saying it for a real reason why. There's a real reason why I'm saying this. There's biblical background and foundation to tell you this, all right? And you don't have to accept it all at one time, but don't throw it away, okay? Do what Mary did. She pondered in her heart the things that Yeshua was saying. Things like, wow, Is this my son? The Son of God? Is my son? You know? Or did she just dismiss it and throw it away? She pondered in her heart. That's all I'm asking you. Just ponder it in your heart. Don't throw it all away. Please don't throw any of it away. But if you cannot digest everything all at one time, then do what cows and sheep do. They ruminate, right? That means they chew. Ruminate, chew means they meditate on what they heard. Mm-hmm. Psalms 1, verse 1 to 3. It's very clear there. The real reason why the psalmist prospered, everything he touched was because he meditated. He chewed on every word that came. So when he arrived upon the scene where Goliath was, guess who was the only one that could handle Goliath? Because he chewed in God's word. His brothers couldn't do it, even though they might have been colonels or generals or whatever. Even though they had invitations all over the place, and poor little David did not have no invitations. God says, I want this one that has no invitations. He can handle Goliath. Why? This is a man of prayer. This is a man after my own heart. This is a man in Torah. All right, sister? Could you stand and say a little bit louder? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. All right. Okay, good. Thank you so much. In closing now, kind of a little quick, you know, recap on this final part, is that this is the month of Heshvan. This is the month, it's called Bitter Month. So what you need to be prepared for is that not last month, because everyone was in a high, but this month, you might begin to feel bad or wrong about something. And that, what you feel, if you pay attention to it, will cause you to leave or to pull out, because you don't understand what this month is really all about. This is the month when things will dry up. Thoughts, the good thoughts that you had about someone else could begin to dry up. You got that? So you got to be careful about this. But it is also the month when the rain will come. See, this is where we can get trapped and the enemy can take advantage of us. Because when things are down and low, the enemy will take advantage of you, because it's kind of like a low week month. And he'll put all these thoughts in your mind, and now you begin to entertain these thoughts, but you don't know that water is coming from heaven in this month also. You see? But you have to pass the test. The fact is that you did not like the test, and you're blaming someone else for the test. All right? Because you're seeing your leaves drying up. You don't see your family cooperating. You don't see, and so you're at a loss, and you begin to pull back, and you say, maybe I was wrong all along. Maybe I should never have really connected, you know. And you begin to pull out. So this is the month where Torah classes begin to get empty. And you don't have full, completely chairs like you normally have. Why is that? Because this is the month bitter. So you see empty areas? What is it saying to you? Did you say that people are too busy? No, they're going through stuff right now. You know? But the Lord says, let the weak. I am strong. You have staying power. Okay? Because that storm for 40 days was very strong. But because God was there and it was God that closed the door, not Noah, it will be God that will open that door too for you. And he'll open it up before this month ends. Something is going to open up if you have staying power. So if you see someone here that's not here, encourage them and explain to them what you just learned today about Heshbon. And let them know the real reason was not that person or even the rabbi. Hallelujah. Hello? Yes. C-H-E-S-H-V-O-N. V-A-N, excuse me. S-H-V-A-N. Heshvan. Heshvan. V-A-N, V-A-N. Heshvan. Yes. But I want to just close with this because that door is going to open up and the dove of peace then will take over. The shalom of the Lord will take over. And then because Heshvan has to do with the supernatural, then God's going to move you into the realm of the supernatural. Okay? Because the letter C, Chet, is the letter of the supernatural power of God. The seven candle there that you see is only complete for this earth. Okay? 6 days you shall work, but on the seventh you shall what? And that has to do not with spiritual but natural rest. And then what? Anything above seven then becomes what? Supernatural. So this is the month, yes, of bitterness for an entire month, but you got to go through this month questioning God, questioning someone else, questioning the rabbi why he said and did not say, why didn't he did not finish. I know why I did not finish what I started. Because God says, stop right now and don't go because you have to go through Heshvan. Okay? So if you sit with me and you just want to hear top good news and you even want to get the kind of consonant that's going to straighten out your problem and I only give the first part of it and you wonder what happened to the second half. Okay? The part that you really wanted me to straighten out your husband. The part that you really wanted me to straighten out somebody else. You did not get that. And that was deliberate because the door will open towards the end of this month. And then the supernatural power of God will flow. So have staying power. Begin the cycle with staying power and you'll complete the cycle. And you will go from a Benjamin to a Methuselah. Okay, staying power. Amen. And everyone say amen.